Hello and welcome back to another episode of Your Drone Questions Answered. I'm John Dickow with the Drone Launch Academy, here to find the answers to your drone questions. These are drone questions that you submit and we find the answers to. So today's question is, what is the difference between an FAA no-fly application and DJI's no-fly application? That's FlySafe. So before we actually start this episode, this is a sponsored episode. And so I want to introduce our sponsor, that is Autopilot. And so Autopilot is an all-in-one, very easy to use drone flight planning app. You can plan your flights, you can check airspace, you can check weather, complete flight checklists, all within that application. And they've just introduced a brand new drone insurance feature, which you can actually purchase your drone insurance right there within the app. You can check your policy. It's all right there. It's all very easy to access. So please check it out. You can download Autopilot on the iOS application store. It's on Android as well. You can actually claim your free drone insurance quote right there. And so check it out. And speaking of Autopilot, I actually have with me head of Autopilot, the guy who did the whole thing. And so I have Tauty Shalna with me. Tauty, thanks for joining me for this special episode. So first, speaking of Autopilot, I did my best explaining all the great features of it, but you could probably dig in a little deeper. And so introduce yourself a little bit more, your involvement with Autopilot and what Autopilot is.
Yeah, absolutely. So my name is Tauty Shalna. I founded Autopilot a few years ago. And basically what Autopilot is the easiest way for any drone pilot to check and understand airspace. You can go into the app, you can search a location by dropping a pin or plugging in an address. And we give you all the flight advisories specific to your flight, right? So you put in the time of the day and we tell you all the information you really need to be able to execute that flight safely. And well, the reason that we're allowed to do that is we're an FAA-approved provider of both LAANC services as well as B4UFLY. So we're able to not only give you all the important information that you need to plan your flight, but we're also able to give you a LAANC request. So you can access LAANC through our app. So if you're trying to fly in controlled airspace, you're able to request authorization right through the app and get it approved almost in real near times, I believe how they describe it. So super easy to use. You can manage your missions, check weather, like you said, and insurance is kind of our new feature to keep kind of plugging in some of the different things that drone pilots need all into one app to really effectively and safely plan their flights.
Awesome. It's really great to have you here. And you're actually the perfect person to answer this question. You mentioned Autopilot is a FAA approved application when it comes to flight planning and obviously the no-fly feature. Going back to our question, what is the difference between an application like yours that is FAA approved to something like DJI FlySafe, which actually is not FAA approved? And so there are some consequences to that. And so I'm going to actually let you just sort of take it away and kind of talk about what really an app like yours provides as opposed to DJI's that doesn't have that FAA approval?
Yeah, that's a great question. And it's probably the one we get the most often is a user who either first uses our app to check airspace and either, get the LAANC approval or sees they don't need it. And then they go to fly their drone, DJI, obviously one of the top drones in the market today with probably 80% of people using it. And they go to take off and their screen simply says, cannot take off. And they're like, why can't I take off? I got a LAANC approval. Or the other way around is people come and ask us, I use DJI, their maps are so much different than yours. I think yours are wrong, right? That's the assumption. They think our maps are wrong for some reason. So it's an interesting question that we get. And I think what's important to understand is one, the FAA and the DJI maps are completely two separate entities, right? So DJI being a Chinese company, obviously don't have any authority over the airspace in the US, but they do have a FlySafe map. And I believe they included it within their products to kind of help alleviate some of the risks that new drone flyers have. Their maps do show, some critical infrastructure. They don't allow you to fly during some certain areas or next to certain infrastructure or areas that they deem are unsafe, like airports, for example. And they want you to go into their website and unlock those areas and kind of get permission from them. That's completely different than the FAA, right? So the FAA, who is the authority of airspace in the US, has a lot more data than DJI supplies a user. So being an FAA-proof provider, we don't just show you, airports and controlled airspace, for example. We also show you things like, national park services, temporary flight restrictions, MOAs, military bases, right? There's a whole slew of other different types of advisories that DJI isn't showing a user. Nighttime advisory, weather warning, right? So they really go on and on. Two applications don't interact at all. So what people don't think is they go check DJI, they think DJI tells them they can fly, they go take off, and they really don't understand that where they're flying maybe is okay, but there's also really high likelihood that they're flying in an area where they shouldn't be. We actually saw this story just recently where a pilot flew over a football stadium, got caught, got in trouble. I think they recently got prosecuted or fined. And they were asked why they flew in that area. And they said, I thought it was okay. The DJI drone that I'm using took off. I unlocked the fly safe. And I thought I was fine. And they didn't go check an FAA-approved provider like us, which is really what you need to do as your first step. So The reason FAA-approved providers are so important is our system actually interacts with the FAA system. So if you plan a mission within our app, you get LAANC approval. That information actually gets shared with the FAA, and it actually gets shared with local air traffic control, which DJI doesn't. So a local air traffic control knows there's a mission going on, a drone mission going on in my controlled airspace. I'm aware of that, and now I can help, you know, give more operational awareness to any pilots in the area. So that's a real big benefit of using an FAA provider, and also just it helps you fly compliantly and know you're following all the regulations. So that's kind of the big, big difference. I know it's kind of a lot to unravel there, but I would say for any pilot who's using DJI, step one is I would always start with an FAA provider. And, you know, obviously founder of Autopilot, I hope you use ours, but being a huge, you know, supporter of an industry, first and foremost, just use any provider. Use anybody to check airspace, right? It only takes one bad actor to unfortunately really, you know, hurt the industry. And we've seen that day in, day out now, where one bad actor, you know, broke the rules, didn't follow FAA guidelines, and then the state legislation made some sort of bill or rules that affects the entire industry. And there's a lot of people, livelihoods are part of the industry. So don't ruin it for all of us but by doing something that maybe you're not supposed to. So go check an FAA-approved provider, understand airspace, where you can and can't fly, get LAANC approval if you have to, or if you're an area that, you know, you can't get LAANC, it's still controlled airspace, you can go through what's called FAA drone zone, file a manual waiver. And then your next step would be go to the drone DJI's no-fly zone. Some of their actual unlock zones require you to show them that you got LAANC, believe it or not. So if you try to unlock like a red zone, they actually ask you, did you get LAANC? You have to upload a file that shows that you got LAANC. But some of their other zones don't ask that. You can just unlock them. But those zones are the ones that are usually still in areas that you really do need approval, or maybe there's some other like special advisories that you didn't understand that you should know. So for any new pilot or any current pilot, I would say FAA-proof provider step one and DJI no-fly step two.
Yeah. And kind of what I'm taking from this too is, first of all, the seriousness of the consequences for breaking the rules and going into a no-fly zone. It's funny you brought up that football game scenario, because it's come up in quite a few episodes of YDQA. And poor guy, whoever did that, I feel for that person who probably just didn't know better. But I think about all the drones out there that are DJI and just how big they are in the drone market and how easy it must be for a beginner drone pilot to see that feature, to see FlySafe and think, okay, good, I'm covered. Consequences such as getting prosecuted, that's crazy. That's like a huge gap in knowledge for a beginner drone pilot not to know to go after an FAA approved.
Well, one thing you should understand too is an FAA approved provider, part of our performance requirements, right? So we have this huge list of performance requirements that we get tested on. And the FAA actually audits our apps consistently. So not only on, you know, quarterly basis, we have meetings for different rule changes that we have to adhere to. We have security audits to make sure our privacy policies and all of our data is secured for all of our users. And we also have performance audits where they're constantly using our app and doing quality assurance tests to make sure all the advisories are correct. They're showing up in the right areas. And if they spot something that maybe isn't correct, they let us know and we have to fix it like right away. So you're getting kind of like the sense of like it's the data's up to date and these all these advisories are true. The second piece is going back to stadiums, there's an advisory that part of the performance rules called stadium notice. And if you drop a pin with any application, including ours, we will within 3 nautical miles of a stadium, you get what's called a stadium advisory that tells you you can't fly 1 hour before or 1 hour after a planned event at the stadium. Our application names the stadium or stadiums that you're 3 nautical miles within and tells you to go check their schedules to make sure that you don't, you know, break those rules. A lot of stadiums now do get TFRs. So our app would also show you that if it's temporary flight restriction that completely was to lock down that airspace. And that's just some features you just aren't going to get with a DJI no flies, right? I honestly don't know how often they update those maps or if they update them at all. I don't know what they're pointing out to you, what they're not. I know definitely a nice layer of protection, I guess, for maybe a really new user who knows nothing and they're telling you, no, you can't fly here. So maybe it nudges them to go check some more items, but definitely not very comprehensive as an FAA-proof provider would be.
Yeah. And for something, like I said, it's something that is just such a big deal. You really don't want to take your chances on something that isn't really a detail, that isn't thorough in terms of what zone, where can you not fly? And I can only imagine.
Especially if you're like a recreational flyer, right? Like you're just trying to go up, maybe snap some photos. You buy this like new little drone you're all excited about. And next thing you know, you like broke a bunch of laws and now you could go to jail, right? You're like, how did this just happen? And all you had to do was find an app, download it and just put down where you're flying, and it would have told you all the things you needed to know about flying in that area.
Now, you mentioned too that it's possible, you know, say if you did end up downloading a no-fly, FAA approved no-fly application, and then you can use FlySafe, because through that no-fly, through the FAA approved application, you can get the proper documentations, proper files, which you can transfer to the FlySafe. But you're even saying that there's a chance that still may not cover everything. No, or FlySafe might still let you into some areas where you need extra approval, you need extra documents.
Yeah. So the one thing that people need to remember is an FAA approved application, at least none that I know about, I mean, ours doesn't for sure, I don't think any others do, none of them communicate with any DJI applications, right?
Even.
So there's no communication of like, you got LAANC using ours, and then like, we don't send that information to DJI. We have no integration with them. And neither does, I think, any other approved app. So then you need to go, you know, still unlock that license or that zone that you're flying in with your DJI drone if you are flying in a zone that needs to have that. Sometimes, even with our application, if you're flying in a, you know, a really restricted area, like an area we just tell you can't fly in, TFRs, next to really some military bases or an MOA, you actually have to even go further than our app. And you might even have to go into what's called Drone Zone, an FAA website, and submit a manual application. And if you didn't do that, if you completely didn't use our app and you didn't know that, and now you're flying a DJI drone that just maybe unlocked it for you, or now you could be in an area that you really shouldn't be in at all. It's a bizarre setup, I will say. It is confusing. The process to unlock some of the zones is a little confusing as well, but I would definitely say you still have to check an FAA approved app first and foremost. That's going to be your kind of like true north to begin with. That would also make it easier if you don't unlock your zones, right? Because like you said, you need to. Sometimes they ask you for documentation. Did you get LAANC? Did you get a waiver to fly in this? I think they're called red zones within the DJI application. And you have to provide that to them.
Okay. Well, like you said, it is good. It can get pretty complicated, it seems, but it is nice to know that there are applications out there that are trying to make it easier. And especially for beginner drone pilots, it's a lot of information to keep in mind. And so the easiest and all-in-one package is pretty useful. But hey, before I let you go, I want to ask you for a little piece of advice for the Drone Launch Academy community. We're a community of learners. We are looking for ways to apply drones, the skills behind drones, to our own careers, or maybe even starting new careers with it. And you're just in a unique place where you've done that. You've found a kind of a niche in the drone world. You started your own company that is really actually helping to propel the drone industry forward. What advice do you have for individuals who are just trying to do the same thing, find a niche and be a part of the drone industry and make a living off of it?
Yeah, I'll even add a little more information there. Before starting Autopilot, I was a drone pilot. I had my own drone service industry business. So I did photography and videography for real estate and hospitality, such as hotels. I did a lot of telecommunication tower inspection. So, you know, I didn't just get into airspace right away. My goal was to be a drone pilot, and I started Autopilot out of a need where I thought, you know, airspace apps today could be a lot easier to use and a lot kind of all in one, have all the applications you need in one place. So that's kind of how I transitioned to where I am today. But for anybody who's out there, we'll start with just anybody who's starting a business, right? I kind of going to answer this by not answering this by saying, a lot of people come up and say, you know, what's your advice? I'm not a huge believer in giving advice or asking for advice. And the reason is because I don't think it helps you. I think people usually give you some really broad answer that, and it doesn't really lead you in a direction that you know, right? You might say, oh, how do I start a drone business? Someone's like, oh, you should really find a good niche and do good marketing and contact, right? That's not that helpful. My big thing that I learned by starting a business was what you need to do instead is ask people for help, because help shows them how much you care about a problem, and it shows them that you probably tried to really solve that problem. So if I came to someone that I was trying to start a drone business, instead of saying, you know, starting a drone business, how do I? You know, what's some advice you have? I might say, look, I really want to start a drone business. I've been a photographer for a while. I just bought a drone. I'm learning to fly. You know, I've been trying to contact people. I haven't really had any success yet. Like, can you help me maybe introduce me to some people, or can I pitch to you what I'm telling people? Maybe you can give me some feedback, right? There's some real actionable items in that sentence. And now you convey to somebody you really care, and that person will almost want to help you before you even ask for the help, because they can see your passion for it, right? So I would tell people, go ask for help. Go find people that you think are really, really valuable to you, or have done it, or you admire, and just ask them for help and see how you'll be surprised how many people are really willing to give you help and kind of lead you along the way. And I think one thing that's been Autopilot so successful was I have an amazing team, and I have a lot of great investors who do to help me. And I go them with items like that and say, this is what I need help with, this is what I can't solve. And when you get a really good chunk of people who are super smart and want to help you, you'll find a lot of success and you'll really start moving things along.
That's great. I really appreciate it. I'm sure our viewership appreciates it too. It's interesting, even as the DLA community, it's a huge networking advantage to connect with those within the drone industry, whether it's doing small business stuff or you're working towards something much greater and working with like higher entities, like people in the FAA. We've talked to people in the military, law enforcement, all kinds of things. And so excellent. Thank you. I really appreciate that. And I really appreciate you, Tauty, for just coming onto this episode, talking about an extremely important topic, but also autopilot. Thanks again for coming on.
Yeah, absolutely. Appreciate you guys having me. And I hope we can do this again someday.
Thanks. Tauty Shalna, he's the founder of Autopilot. Again, Autopilot, all-in-one drone flight planning app. It's everything from planning flights, checking airspace, weather, drone insurance now, they do. And so you can actually purchase drone insurance off of Autopilot, access the policy, really cool stuff. And a very important application when it comes to no-fly zones. It's FAA approved. Can't say that enough. Go for the FAA approved applications, and Autopilot is a great application to go with. So thanks again. And hey, if you got a question, anything about drones at all, we can answer that question. You can go on to ydqa.io, type in your question there. We'll see it. Or speaking of community, there's the Drone Launch Connect community. We see questions come through there all the time. We are constantly scouring that and collecting questions to go find the answers to it. So if you got a question, type it in there too. We will see it. In the meantime, we'll see you in the sky.